Welcome back to Let's Interactively Play Steve Jackson's Sorcery, the Let's Play where you get to vote on what is to happen at the beginning of the next video. Unfortunately, only two people voted, and they both voted for different things. So now we have to flip. Gonna do a 1d4. Guys, please vote. I'm getting, like, hardly any votes. Por favor. Pretty please. Sugar on top. Etc. Anyway. A roll of 1 or 2 will be to prod the foot. These are in order of the choices in the game. And a roll of 3 and 4 will be going for the box. So let's see what we get. We got a 1. We're going to prod the foot. Okay. Getting ready to prod someone in the foot. We'll be sticking those toes. Now, if you guys see stuff up here or down here, you might apologize. Shadowplay is acting weird. I always had to record in desktop mode, and now I don't have to. So maybe now it records OpenGL? I have no idea. Anyway, we're in this room with a large table and chair. It is a sealed box in the corner. Blah, blah, blah. I read all this last time. There's a foot sticking out from under the table. Clawed and a shade of gray-green. It's about the size of my head. So the house feels dead. We're nervous. The person under the table is, or creature under the table is not dead. But we are going to prod this thing as the results of our roll last time. 3, 2, 1, prod. Reaching forward with your sword, you cautiously prod one toe of the foot. Nothing happens. I'm going to keep with the result. I'm going to go forward with prodding. Feeling more confident now, you prod it once more. Still nothing. It seems like this creature is either very asleep or very dead. Okay, then we're going for the box, which is the other option. No longer concerned about the creature, you head over to the box and lift the lid. Inside are a series of small, round stones, carefully carved. I'm going to lift out a stone, but I have to wonder if the state of this being under the table was caused by messing with these stones. Let's find out what happens. Lift out a stone. You pick out one of the stones at random and lift it from the box. It isn't heavy, but it is exquisitely smooth. Not quite round, with a dimple at the top and a deeper pit near the top. In fact, you realize as you turn it over in your hand, it is carved in the shape of an apple. Looking in the box, you see other carved foodstuffs. Apples, bread, rolls of goat cheese, a ham. Each has been almost perfectly chiseled into shape. All this crap turned to stone. But a Medusa turns living things to stone. Well, things that can look at it. I mean, technically, at one point, some of the stuff was alive. Apples. I mean, bread, maybe? Yeast? Ham? By the time you're looking at ham, it's already dead. But apples could be considered alive. I don't know. Very hesitantly choosing, looking through the stone food. You search through the box, hoping to find something to explain the purpose of the collection. But you discover nothing more. Turning away, your eyes fall on the other side of the table, where the head of the creature lies. The face is clearly stone, the eyes are stone, the open mouth is stone. It is a statue of a Zvin, or else it once was a Zvin. In its hand you see it hold a stone shovel. Let's examine the shovel. You peer at the shovel. It has a wide blade, good for heavy digging. This creature was a gardener, perhaps, or a farmer, or more likely, given his lonely outpost near the Necropolis, a city grave digger. but now he is solid stone. Such things are not impossible. Perhaps he buried a wizard's lover. A wizard's lover. A day too soon, perhaps. You step back outside into the dying sunlight. Well, that was interesting. I was sure we were going to be turned to stone here. It still could pretend greater danger related to that, though. Through the wasteland. You make your way between blasted walls and weed-encrusted rubble. There is constant movement in the corner of your eyes. Rats scurrying to hide under stones and in the cracks. The path turns around a large stone fountain, which has toppled over on one side, revealing an empty well shaft leading down into the earth. Not going to drop a coin. It probably leads back into those catacombs that we saw, which are not magical. Which we've been in there 3 times already. Can I look at the fountain without falling in? I'm really hesitant, because every time I... Okay. The fountain is carved to resemble a gigantic serpent, leaning up from the base of the pedestal, with its jaws open to devour a marble sun. Openings in the stone suggest that when the fountain was working, water ran between its scales and down onto the base, as though the serpent was being pushed down by a rainstorm. Okay, I'm going to move on. You follow the path around the edge of the wasteland. I'm still looking for this guy. How do we get to the Gardens of Prior? Edge of the wasteland. Well, there's a fence. So unless I'm going to climb up the fence, I might be headed back around this way. Or just trotting through all this. Edge of the wasteland. After a while, another path joins this one. Looking back along it, you see a toppled steeple. A track climbs the rise at your back toward a low hovel. This is the far edge of the wasteland. Ahead, you can make out a line of tall, dark trees. Let's check out the hovel, and if we can, then after that, the steeple. I want to lead back around and go... You know, look at the fallen quarter somewhere. We're looking for that guy who's a blind beggar. At least I think he's blind. I know he's a beggar. A little hovel. Maybe he lives in here. You climb the rise towards the hovel. It is merely a tent pitched in a clearing, guy ropes held down by rubble. Well, if it's a tent, there's no door. So how can we listen at it? But sure, I'll listen at the flap of the tent. You stand and hold your breath, but you hear nothing from inside. Perhaps it is unoccupied. Certainly, it can't contain much. Go in. You step into the shade of the tiny hovel and your eyes widen. The room inside is lined, floor to ceiling, with trinkets, knick-knacks, bric-a-brac, and other miscellaneous stuff. Some is piled up on the shelves, some hangs from the ceiling, and even more leans against the walls. There are weapons, pottery, jewelry, domestic objects, magical items, and so on. And a witch or something. Or a wizard. Sitting cross-legged on the floor in the midst of all this mess is a small bearded gnome, who rubs his hands and greets you as you come in. Greetings, gnome. Greetings, the gnome answers enthusiastically. He pats the ground beside him. Let's see if we can do a little bartering. As you can probably tell, I have no interest in money. The gnome gestures around his little room. There is clearly a lot to choose from, but the items which stand out are a pot of beeswax, a bag of goblin's teeth, a cloth skullcap, and a compass, whose needle quivers in a direction which is close to, but not actually north. What would you like? The gnome asks. Now, at least 3 of these objects... or for use in magical spells. I can't look at my spellbook now, right? Can I? Okay. I'm just going to stop that for a second because it gets very loud. what is it again? The Goblin's Tooth. Do we still have that? We have Giant's Tooth. We have that back? That doesn't get used up? Guess I thought we did have a Giant's Tooth. I might be mistaken, guys. The Goblin's Tooth, as far as that is. The Giant's Tooth I know we used. I guess it doesn't get used up with the spell. That's pretty cool. So obviously the Goblin's Tooth is used to conjure a goblin or goblins. I have an S in parentheses here. I guess there's a chance for one or more. And Giant's Tooth is used to summon a giant. What's the other stuff? The beeswax. Beeswax is for the Raz spell. R-A-Z. Blade does 2 times or more damage. And compass. I don't recall that being... I'm just looking. I don't recall that being a magical, you know, component. I don't see it, but I have a few more written on the other side. Nope, I don't see it. The bracelet of bone we do have is used for an enhanced illusion, the kid spell. And the skull cap, right. The skull cap is for reading minds. Pretty cool. I'd say the skull cap, then, at least as far as the magical components, is the most valuable thing. Because reading minds is pretty cool, you know, as long as you have the option, you know, you have that option to cast that spell, which is, I think it's tel, T-E-L, yeah, for telepathy. Bartering. You turn the cloth skull cap over in your hands. Anything else? The gnome asks. What does he want? He has no interest in money. What do we have? I mean, as far as items... Oh, I have it. It says I have it now. That wasn't there before, right? I don't have much to give him. I don't have any rations right now. Unless he wants a giant net or an essence of bark or a tinderbox. Hope I'm not locked into this. I'm not sure if I should choose other things or just start with this. I don't know if I have an option to, you know, barter with him again. So let's compromise and choose the compass. It's not a normal compass, the gnome says. Instead, it'll point you to where it thinks you need to go. I'm afraid it has a mind of its own, and it isn't always correct. And it probably won't work in the countryside outside Kharé either, so I'd understand if you don't want it. Yeah, I don't need a compass that will point me to wrong areas, especially I'm bartering for it. I'll put it back. The gnome nods. That's 2 items so far. The gnome remarks, counting on his fingers. Wait, that's 1. I put it back. What? That's enough then. I'm afraid I'm gonna get screwed over by this. That's enough. You say, standing back. All done? Oh, now he says you took one of mine. Very good. You took one of mine, so I've taken one thing of yours. I'm very quick. You probably didn't notice me doing it. Good day. The gnome gestures towards the door for you to leave. Wait, what did you take? The gnome looks surprised. Well, really, I have no idea. I'm a kleptomaniac, and as should be fairly obvious, and what's more, I couldn't see into your pack when I was taking it, could I? But I'm very fair, and I took exactly the right amount of things, so we're all square. Well, you can look at it now and see. Tell me what it is. Look around for my things. You look around the crowded hovel, but you can see the gnome's point. In all the piles of things, you don't recognize any of your belongings, and it's hard to be quite sure what he took anyway. Did I always have 10 stamina? Alright. We had 4 things. Those things are there. He can't take a clue, right? Doesn't make sense. Did he take my weapon? It would definitely show me what if something was missing, wouldn't it? At this point? Should I take something else? Watch my stamina too. My stamina is 10. I'm not sure what we started with, but 10 doesn't seem familiar. You look around for something else to take, but in the rubbish fail to see anything at all useful. Well, what about those 2 things that he had? For a moment, you seem to see something move in the corner of your eye. Look here, the gnome says. I can't help it. And in all this talking about it, I've gone and stolen something else from you. So really, I do advise you to just leave. You open your pack and look. Has something else gone missing? You can't tell. It's such a jumble. You feel something touch your side for a moment, but when you look around, there is nothing else. There's nothing there. And another, remarks the gnome, rather sadly. What? What's missing? I need to take 2 more things out of here. He took the mask. The face mask. These are here. God damn it. Make sure I still have my sword. That's my just gold. Make sure he didn't take my spellbook. Clues, of course, aren't going to be affected. Well, what else did I have? I don't even remember. The beeswax he was offering, I didn't get a chance for that. Did I have a flute? Skull cap I now have. The black face mask, I know I have that. There's something else. He took the bracelet of bone. God damn it. Bracelet of Bone does what? Enhanced illusion. Crap. I am not happy right now. This place is a disaster. You head out of the hovel. You return back along the path to the junction. I can only go this way. Let's check again. Yes. Yes. It takes magical items. But the first time he didn't take anything. That I could see. Unless it was a key or something. Just making sure. Wow. After a while, another path joins this one. Looking back along it, you see a toppled steeple. You are back at the far edge of the wasteland. Ahead, the sun is setting behind the trees ahead. Okay, let's head to the steeple. No reason to go to the fence unless I'm going to hop over it. I mean, I've been in Necropolis, so I'm just going to head this way. Ooh, is that him? You make your way through the wasteland towards a church. Most of the building is in ruins, but a tall steeple still reaches for the sky. Circling the temple are two dark shapes that look like enormous birds. At the foot of the church, a man dressed in rags is curled up, asleep. I'm a little nervous about these two dark shapes. Look at him. You stop and peer down at him. Could this be Theta, the blind beggar that you were told to find? I hope so. Under a floppy hat and above a thick briar bush beard, two white eyes glow slightly like orbs. This poor creature is not only blind, he has no eyelids at all. Huh. Wake him. We gotta talk to him. You reach down and wake him gently. At first he doesn't respond, and you wonder if you are too late. But then he sits up sharply. Too late what? That he'd be dead? Who's there? He demands. I'm under attack! I'm under attack! He rubs his eyes, then reaches out with dirty fingertips for your face. Let's be polite and introduce myself. Greetings, you say. The beggar groans and grumbles. What do you wake me for? I can see in my dreams, you know. I'd rather stay there. Who are you? You demand. I'm nobody, the beggar insists. Nobody at all. You are Theta, noble of Kharé. You round on the beggar. You are Theta. Theta, are you not? The man looks absolutely terrified by the accusation. He begins to curl up around himself and scream. It seems quite a strong reaction. But then he is not looking at you, but past you. Oh, those dark shapes. You turn your attention skyward to see the two shapes are hurtling downwards, beating wide, leathery wings. These are the creatures you saw flying around the steeple. God cursed harpies, he declares bitterly. They come for me every time. Every coin I get, every apple, every stinking crust of bread, they come and they take it from me. What did I do to deserve such torment? I'm going to defend him. So right, we had an option to give something to him, so I'm sure if we had given something to him, they would have flown down to, you know, get it. So why are they flying down from now? I didn't give him anything. Maybe they're going to try to get rid of me. Step in front of the beggar. You ease the man aside and stare up into the sky. The harpies are screaming down towards him. Ugly, dark-skinned creatures with sharp talons on their arms and legs, coming to tear out what is left of his eyes. Damn. Let's cast a spell. Hell yeah. What would be good in this situation? Should I cast my, a lightning bolt? Fireball? Or something more like a confusion kind of spell or something. We have quite a collection. Well, this is a D. Dim? Oh, is that like a charm animal or something, right? Hold on. I gotta see what that is. It's probably a good one. Where is this spell? I'm not seeing it. Dim. Oh, confuse. Confusion. Cool. Stupidity. Boom. Huh. You cast a spell over the first harpy, which begins to reel and stagger in the air as though drunk. It seems these creatures are not especially clever, as it quickly forgets how to fly properly and begins dropping from the air, then rising up to high, and finally takes to repeatedly flying itself into the side of a nearby building. This continues until the harpy has brained itself unconscious. It crashes to the ground in a plume of dirt. You gather your strength for the next battle. Okay, so there was two of them, so I'm guessing we got rid of one. Should I start off bold? Thrust! Oh, crap! Eesh! The second harpy swoops low, screaming out for blood. You chop into the air with your sword, but the harpy is coming at you with terrific force, and its claws tear chunks from your side. The harpy wheels up and turns about, ready to strike. Look out, cries the beggar. He's going for your head. I'm defending. You fall back. The harpy screams downwards, but you repel it with your blade. You are gasping for breath, suffering from deep and wide wounds. The creature hovers, just a little out of reach, talons stretched. Gotcha. All that just for one point, though. You pause, waiting for the harpy's wings to open. Then you launch forwards. You slice with your sword. It comes down for you, then tries to turn and retreat, but is too late. Your sword sinks into its bony hide. It darts away up into the ancient rafters. That didn't... Oh. That didn't do anything. I didn't even hit anything. Leaping up from a low crouch, you strike for the beast's skull, but the harpy is far off the ground. It screams as it crosses the sky. Okay, I'm defending. Good choice. You drop into a crouch. The harpy wheels about, then dives at great speed, but you stay covered. It hangs in the air, a short way back, claws grasping. Leaping up from a defensive position, you aim for the beast's thick neck. The harpy rages as your blade sinks deep. It flaps upwards, but then looks down with beady eyes, ready to drop down on you. You fall back. The harpy dives downwards, but you knock it aside with your sword. The evil harpy stays low to the ground, a little distance from you, talons flexing. I can't seem to do more than one point of damage. Suddenly you reach out. You hold your ground as the harpy swoops, driving your sword blade up into its belly from underneath. Your sword slashes into one of the harpy's eyes. The harpy dribbles dark blood as it flies. The harpy lifts away once more away and comes about, ready to strike. We're even now, although I'm missing a lot more stamina. So did I drive my sword blade into its belly or into its one of its eyes? Well, it's ready to strike, so I'm defending. And we're almost dead. You drop into a crouch. The harpy dives downwards, but you dodge quickly into the cover of the building behind. You feel your vision swim and dance. The beggar is covering his head and muttering endless prayers. Done it. Oh, I thought I had one point left. Never mind. You wait for the harpy to move in close, and then you charge forwards. You cleave the air with your blade, cutting it out of the air, sending it tumbling backwards into the ruins. The creature hovers further than your sword length, claws scraping the dirt. So I guess this won't work. It did. I am gonna try again, because we have one stamina is no good and we have no food. I think we have one like magic drink we can take, but it only gives you back like 2 or 3 points. Leaping up from a defensive position, you strike with the beast's thick neck. With a final turn through the air, the harpy barrels over, then tumbles, striking the side of the church. As it hits the ground, a wall collapses, and the creature is buried beneath a slide of masonry. The beggar cheers and begins to dance. 8 stamina lost. Shameful. Trying again. Okay, I'm defending. The second harpy swoops low, screaming out for blood. You drop behind a ruined pillar. The harpy collides into your defense. Spell wrong? With full force. Don't let him get you, cries the beggar unhelpfully. I'm defending again. Actually, I could have, like, hit hard. Alright, we're gonna cut. Actually, if I remember right, it hardly does any damage at this point, so I'm gonna try sideswipe. You pause, waiting for the harpy's wings to open, then you strike. Leaping up from a low crouch, you charge for its thick neck. It comes down for you, then tries to turn and retreat, but it's too late. Your sword sinks into its bony hide. Short way back. Right. You strike for the harpy's leathery wings. It furies as your blade connects. It wheels up and turns about, ready to strike. Look out, he's going for your head. Defend. Good choice there. Good. Better. 3 stamina lost. Decent dueling. Much better. 6 is a lot better than 1. So. The beggar creeps out from his hiding place and thanks you 2 or 3 times over. We stupid now to leave him. We need information from him. Lord Theta, I'd like to talk to you. That's my name. I don't deny it. I'll talk to you. I'll talk to you happily. Ever since the blindness struck me down, I have been tormented by those demons, and now they are dead. You have saved me, or as much as I can be saved. What happened to your eyes? You take a moment to show some sympathy. What happened to your eyes? A black eye curse, and I know who cursed me. It was Sansas. Once he was a good ruler, fair and honest, he ruled Kharé like a kind father looking after a cherished daughter. Nothing was too much effort, but he began to fear his other counselors. He thought we were plotting against him, ready to overthrow him. Go on. You can see he is shaking at the very act of remembering. You gesture for him to continue. Well, the beggar whispers, he began to take actions against us. First, moving the portal traps around without telling us. Then later, people started to disappear. Shinva first. He was cursed to a living death. Then Mulas, equally cursed, to a dying life. And then me. He begins to weep once more. The beggar shivers against a sudden breath of cold. The afternoon is waning. Evening is approaching already. Days are growing shorter, Theta remarks. It's like that here, near the backlands. Huh. Tell me your spell line for the gate. Happily, he says, I'm glad to be rid of it. It was... Oh, no. My memory is not as good as it was. Let me see. It was... He racks his brains, thinking for all he is worth. I'm not going to hit him. Wait. You wait patiently for him to remember. Got it, he exclaims. It's by Korga's grace and something's pride. Oh, but I can't remember what the something was. The beggar makes a coughing sound. I'm starving, he whispers. So hungry. But you have no food you could offer him. That's correct. Tell me the order of the spell lines. Is that the same? The order of the spell lines for the North Gate, do you know it? Theta laughs. Haha, no idea. Although, I know my line came first. Try to remember the rest of the line. He shakes his head. It's gone. I fear it's gone, like my sight. It was the name of a god. One of the old gods. The god of pride. Oh, I know it's Korga. We actually visited Korga before we rewound back into the wasteland. The god of pride, no less. Maybe you can find out elsewhere. You could ask Korga, the god of grace. Oh, Korga's the god of grace. Never mind. For his help. The god lives in a temple that way. He waves roughly northwards. Tell me about Korga. You ask, how can he help me? Korga sees all and knows all. Suddenly the beggar grips your wrist and squeezes, but you risk your life if you talk to him. Remember, please, the left eye. That's how you start. The left eye. Right, yeah, the solution we solved before. And I know to skip the circles. You gotta make a cross, starting with the left eye, I guess, yeah. And, the circles on the way to the, statue. Or idol, whatever, we, skip. You thank the beggar once more for his help, incomplete as it was. Then you look to the track ahead and take your leave of him. You return to the junction. One new clue and others have been updated. We can only go back to the edge of the wasteland again. Well, we've pretty much thoroughly explored this area. I'm not even sure if you can go here. I mean, maybe. So let's see what clues we have. Loud music. Second noble Mulas is a corpse. He's been cursed and is now a living corpse who torments the citizens of Kharé. Half of Theta's spell line. By Korga's grace and someone's pride. Okay. Okay. Now I just gotta get to a point where there's a choice. That seems at least somewhat important. Edge of the Wasteland. You return to the far edge of the wasteland. Ahead, the sun is almost gone and the trees glow with color. So we can only go to this fence. So that's where I'm going. The path ends at a tall and ancient iron fence overgrown with weeds. Through the dense leaves, you can make out a wide area beyond, dotted with stones and small buildings and straight, somber trees. It is a necropolis of mausoleums and tombs. Hmm. I had turned back because I want to take another one of those potions. At least I think I have a potion. Blackbriar potion? The other way is back through the wasteland, but the hour is getting late, and you have wasted a lot of time crossing it. In the dark, you might fall and twist your ankle on the rough brick and uneven stone. But if there is no way through or over the fence, then you have no choice. Something, a rat, perhaps scurries through the fence and back into the wasteland. I do need to go here, but... I could just as easily twist my ankle on stuff in the necropolis. Alright, I'm climbing. I want to take one of those, though. You test the ivy. It seems tightly wound about the railings. Wedging one toe between the metal bars, you grip the cords of the plant and haul your way up. Then the second foot is up, and you are climbing, though you can feel the plant tearing under your hands. Jump down, down on the other side, or jump down on this side? Keep climbing. Oh god, I just lost 3 stamina. You keep going, hoping that if you move quickly, you will clear the fence before the ivy comes away. You don't manage it. Near the very top, you feel the sap leaking between your fingers as the cords of the plant snap. Then you fall painfully back onto the rubble-strewn ground. However, all is not lost. Where the plant has torn away from the fence, a foxhole has been revealed, leading underneath the fence. Climb it. I can't fight anything like this. This is ridiculous. You kneel down and wriggle your way into the foxhole. It is so narrow that you have to keep your arms out in front of you and drag your pack along behind. But thankfully it is short, coming up on the other side of the fence less than 2 strides away. You pull yourself up from a hole in the ground into a graveyard. All right. Wait, that's not what I want. No, I don't have anything I can take. I need food. I have all this gold and no food. I think that's what he took. I think that's the third thing he took. And a Blackbriar potion. Well, I'll have to rewind if I come across, like, anything. You are once again standing in the city necropolis, in the shadow of the yews and gravestones. The wind whistles between the tall trees. The sun is setting behind the wall. Look around the gravestones. You step nervously off the path and walk between the nearest tombs. Some are ancient, headstones tilted to crazy angles, and some of them fallen face down, as though the citizens of this graveyard had been drinking since they died. I remember that. Others are fresh, neatly carved, and clean of all moss and weeds. They sparkle in the moonlight, as though cleaned by maids and waiting for their occupants to arrive. The newer tombs. We only need to look for Shinva. Excuse me. I don't remember where exactly I found. So let's look for Oxal to Tamarin. It was Rift's tomb. Now I'm just going to go right to Shinva's mausoleum. Priya's gravestone is where... Isn't that where you found the Bracelet of Bone? Yeah, no one has left her found. Okay, we didn't get to go to Shinva's mausoleum because we got interrupted by the Death Wraith when we looked at Rift's tomb, so let's go to right to Shinva. You approach Shinva's mausoleum. Carved above its door is, here rests Lord Shinva, fifth noble of Kharé. Your heart hammers. Is this the undead noble you are warned you would need to find? Clues have been updated. And we have a final destination. Lord Shinva is the fifth noble of Kharé, but he is dead and buried in the necropolis of Kharé, where his ghost still haunts. Well, don't fight me, ghost. I'm a friendly adventurer. Oh my. The door to Shinva's mausoleum seems to be unlocked and is a crack ajar, as though someone regularly came and went. Just in front of it is a ring of little mushrooms growing up against the front side of the mausoleum. Why am I going to cast a spell? Let's look at the ring of mushrooms. You crouch down to look at the mushrooms. They look highly poisonous, not least because you cannot see a single insect crawling around or under any of them. Very smart. Unusually, the ring itself is also perfectly circular in shape. In its center, something silver glints, a stake pushed into the soft soil. Right, perfectly circular. We were told to avoid anything circular. So I'm gonna cast for like trap or safest way out. There's like two spells like that. I now have a read mind spell, but there's no one here that I can see whose mind I can read. So we have how, which is psychic info, safest escape. And we have something else. Detects S-U-S. Detects trap, best protect action. Now I see S. I do see H as well. Sense danger. You cast a spell and your mind is filled with a clear sense of danger rising from the circle of mushrooms in front of you. Presumably they are poisonous, but you would surely not have been tempted to eat them anyway, so isn't the spell being overly cautious? Before you can decide, the magic fades. We're gonna die. Make a move. It is too cold to stand still in the shadow of the wall. I'm jumping over the ring. Sorry, I'm not leaving that up to you guys. You take a run up and jump clear over the circle of the mushrooms, landing on the step of the mausoleum. Danger from circles. And I have two stamina. It'd probably kill me. The air inside is freezing. Dust coats the floor. Urns line the walls. But there is no coffin. The floor space is empty, except for in the far corner where a narrow stone staircase leads down into darkness. I'm not going to cast a spell this time. Skulls peer at you from the walls. Go down the stairs. What? You make your way towards the stairs, but you must have stepped on some kind of switch, as behind you you hear a noise, and you turn to see the door is swinging shut. Try to block it. You turn around for something to block the door with, but all that comes to hand is a skull. You place it into the gap in the doorway. The door slab continues to move, and the skull is pulverized into powder. Then it seals with a bang, and you are plunged into darkness, filled only with the sound of your own breathing. And one other noise, a distant rattle of chains. So I'm not going down. Oh, look at that. But I can only go this way in the dark. Oh, I got a light tinderbox. The echo of the slamming door circles the room. Things are moving across the flagstones. Light the tinderbox. You fumble for the tinderbox and strike it. A spark flashes, but without any tinder, the flame cannot catch and goes dark just as quickly as it lit. You dig through your pack for something flammable. I'm not going to burn my spellbook. You close your pack once more. It isn't worth the loss. The darkness is absolute. Anything could have your throat in this gloom. Pray for aid. You close your eyes and raise a fervent prayer to the baboon. It's been a while. For a moment you do not think it is heard, and then somewhere underground you hear a mighty crash, as though a heavy weight had fallen from a fraying rope. The door shudders in response. It seems the counterweight which had caused it to close has come away, so you should now be able to open the door. Getting your fingers into the crack between door and wall, you are able to prise it open a fraction, and then a little further still, until the cool air of the graveyard is flowing into the mausoleum. You gasp with relief. Something rushes across your boots and into a crack in the stone. Now should I try to go down the stairs? I do have to solve the mystery of Shinva, don't I? You head for the stairs once more, but the light from the doorway does not go far. Halfway down, the dark is absolute once more. Let's see if everything will turn out alright. Probably not. Menacing sounds echo up from the depths of the crypt. The clanking of chains, the moaning of wind. Perhaps there is some kind of machine down here. Perhaps the mechanism that operated the door? Surely it can be nothing worse? Freeze. You stop still. Something reaches out and touches your neck with an ice-cold grip that tightens and tightens. I'm gonna run, because I can't fight. You turn to run, but the grip around your neck is too tight for you to move. You begin to choke. Struggle? You twist and turn about, but you only shake the last air from your lungs. Then, just as you think you will never breathe again, a heavy blade is pushed into your heart, and you die from that instead. You have been stabbed in the dark. I can't fight like this. I'm going to rewind. Hate to do this. But I need food. I need stuff. There's gotta be something. If I can head back to... although it's late, Fireview Square. Turn back. Head back through the wasteland. You turn and head back through the wasteland, picking your way cautiously between fallen walls and rubble in the near darkness. Suddenly you stumble. You were walking through the ruins of a house across a circular mosaic, and then you are falling. Oh, circles! Not a circle. God damn. You have fallen into a portal trap once more. You brace yourself as you tumble through the air, knowing full well what is coming. Yep. Avoid the goblins no matter what you do. Goblins come down that other tunnel. The distant light grows closer. Whatever it is moving quicker than you. Ice cold water drips from the ceiling and runs down your neck. Retreat. Let's hide. The marching goblins. I thought they came down from that way, though. Yep. We've seen this before. Okay, now we will go this way. Just quickly checking to see if there's anything new, noteworthy. Didn't I go this way? I remember looking at all this stuff. I just wanna... finding nothing. Nothing more. Which way now? Why this way? This way. I don't know why I'm just retracing. Oh, we can drink from the water, can't we? Drink. Oh yeah. Forgot about that. The only game I can think of where drinking water has such an effect on you. Oh, the slime eater again. How about that Raz spell? Sharpen blade. Don't I not? Ah! I thought I wouldn't be able to actually choose it. Ah. Crap. It just beat me. Ah, man. I'm gonna redo this anyway. When it drops below the water, that's when you strike. This was a pretty easy one. Doing again. Defending. You can just do a side swipe. A jab. Really, that's all you need to do, is just jab at it. Oh, God. Well, I still beat it. Skilled swordplay. One stamina loss. Good. Continue. Beyond the slime eater. Right, so we come up this way. Doesn't this lead up near the Fireview Square? Now we're in Necropolis. I don't think we can even go back through this way. I really want to go get some food. So what do you guys think? With 6 stamina, should we go back to Shinva's tomb? Or should we advance forward? So yeah. Those are our 2 choices. Back towards the north gate, at which point I'm gonna hit this again and talk with Korga. And then head for the north gate, I suppose. And then I might... I always have the option to rewind back into the upper district. The red quarter, I guess that is. But anyway, ultimately, we'd head back there anyway. So let me know what you guys think. Should I deal with the ghost of Shinva? Wherever that is, down in the basement? Or back this way towards the north gate? Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you next time, and endure. And don't forget to vote. And enduring, grow strong.